We'll just start with the introduction. Rickettsiae and related organism, but mostly Rickettsiae. These are small gram-negative aerobic and highly pleomorphic coccobacilli. They are gram-negative. Remember, they cannot be stained by gram-negative. Sorry, they cannot be stained by gram staining. The gram negativity is mainly because of the structure of its cell wall. Nothing more than that. So they are very small. So initially they too were considered to be perhaps viruses. They are pleomorphic and they're neither bacilli nor cocci, so they are coccobacilli. So the genus Rickettsia is named after Howard Taylor Ricketts, who discovered it. Belongs to the family Rickettsiaceae and order Rickettsiales. Genome is very small. It's an obligate intracellular parasite. Note this point, just as with chlamydia, which I spoke the other day. These are also obligate intracellular parasites. That means they multiply only when they are inside a living cell. Outside the cell, they do not multiply. So they are obligate intracellular parasites. So they reside mostly in the cytoplasm of the host cell or in the nucleus. These are intracellular parasites which may reside either in the cytoplasm or the nucleus of the host cell. As I already stated, cannot be stained with gram staining. So the best way to stain them are Jimsa, Castaneda, or Machiavello or Jimenez stain. So when stained with Jimsa or Castaneda, they appear bluish purple. And when stained with Machiavello or Jimenez stain, they appear red. Remember, they are stained intracellularly. So the cell wall is triple layered. Membrane is also triple layered and they may have an outer slime layer. And most importantly, they cannot live in artificial environment. That is, they cannot be grown in artificial cultures. So they can be grown in tissue cultures or eggs. In 1938, it was Cox who discovered that the typhus rickettsiae will grow without difficulty in embryonic chicken. Already stated this. They grow best in cells not metabolically active. So they're cultured on cell lines such as the mouse fibroblast, HeLa cells, Hep2 cells, Detroit 6 cell lines. For animal inoculation, guinea pig and mice may be used, no longer used actually. It can be propagated in arthropods also. So you can have arthropods reared in laboratory and you can infect them, done only for research purposes. So basically remember that this Rickettsiae are parasites of ticks, fleas, lice and mites. So these are arthropods. Ticks, fleas, lice, mites. These are the arthropods. So they reside in the alimentary tract, the intestine, GIT of the arthropods. So human disease are arthropod transmitted. In humans, they mainly affect the vascular endothelium of the blood vessels, and that of reticuloendothelial cells or reticuloendothelial organs such as liver, spleen, bone marrow, and so on. Remember this, most of them have similar susceptibility pattern that they can be treated with tetracycline, chlorpheniclone, ciprofloxacin, doxycycline, and so on. These are some of the common features. Now, yesterday I made this mind map, because I told you that this is going to be difficult, it's going to be confusing. So just have a look at this mind map here. So I started with my center point here is Rickettsiae and related organism. Why so? Because Coxiella and Bartonella, these were initially included as a part of Rickettsiae, but no longer now. So what is the first thing we'll see about? What are the common properties of Rickettsiae? They're obligate intracellular parasite. They're gram negative but can't be gram stained. They don't grow in culture medium. They can be grown only on tissue culture cells. They live in arthropods, and human diseases are arthropod transmitted, affect vascular endothelium, and these are the drugs. Now, in what way? Okay, which are the members here? The members are there are two families in Rickettsiae, Rickettsiaceae and Anaplasmataceae. So their members include under Rickettsiaceae family, the two important genera, genus singular, genera plural. The two important genera are Rickettsia genera and Orientia. Earlier they were all maybe perhaps the same, but now they have been separated. The second family is Anaplasmataceae. Members include Ehrlichia, Wolbachia and Anaplasma. I will not be speaking of Wolbachia and Anaplasma. These have similar properties. These are Rickettsiae, the two Rickettsiae, Rickettsiaceae and Anaplasmataceae. to this mind map, I started by saying that Rickettsiae, two important families, Rickettsiaceae and Anaplasmataceae. Rickettsiae has two important genera. Now you know three names to remember. I'll make it short. Three names to remember: Rickettsia genus, Urensia genus, Ehrlichia genus. These three, remember, are Rickettsia group of organisms. Clear? Right. Now, which are the other bacteria which were earlier considered to be Rickettsia but are not Rickettsia? They include Coxiella. Coxiella, not a Rickettsia because it is not arthropod borne. Next is Bartonella. Why is Bartonella not a Rickettsia? Because it is not an obligate intracellular pathogen. It can be cultured in cell-free medium. So these are the two important characteristics, right? If you remember here, for it to be a Rickettsia, it is arthropod borne and it can be grown in artificial culture medium, right? Okay. So now when we talk about Rickettsia, Urensia and Ehrlichia, let us look at the diseases caused by them. Rickettsia is known to cause two types of diseases. Very simple. Please try to remember this. The genus Rickettsia is responsible for two groups of fever: the spotted fever and the typhus fever. Rickettsia, spotted fever, typhus fever. Then there is Urensia, which is another genus of Rickettsia. It is responsible for scrub typhus. So scrub typhus is not caused by the genus Rickettsia, but is caused by the genus Urensia. So these three groups you'll have to remember. They may be very confusing. Spotted fever and typhus fever are caused by Rickettsia. Scrub typhus is caused by Urensia. Now let us see which are the spotted fever groups. As the name itself indicates, spotted fever means there are rashes. Exanthematous rashes. There are many species here. And different species, the diseases caused by these species have been given different names. For example, Rickettsia rickettsii. This species is associated with Rocky Mountain Spotted Fever, RMSF. Rickettsia acari is associated with rickettsial pox. Rickettsia conori is associated with a disease which has got many names. It's called Bouchner's fever. It's also known as Indian tick typhus. There are three or four more names. We'll see that later. And then there are other species of Rickettsia, but I'll be talking about only these three: Rocky Mountain spotted fever, rickettsial pox, and Bouchner's fever. Among this spotted fever group, I'll be talking about only these three. If we come to the second fever group caused by Rickettsia, the disease here is typhus. Typhus fever obviously will produce typhus. There are two types of typhus here. One is epidemic typhus and endemic typhus. Epidemic typhus is caused by Rickettsia provosaceae, whereas endemic typhus is caused by Rickettsia typhi. This epidemic typhus has got a disease which relapses, which comes again after treatment. It comes back. And that is called recrudescence, or also known as Brill-Zinser disease. This is a commonly asked 3 marks question. Brill-Zinser disease is a recrudescent form of epidemic typhus, right? So we have the spotted fever group where you see rashes, and then you have got the typhus fever group, which is further of two types, epidemic and endemic. And the second genera of Rickettsiae are Urensia. It is responsible for scrub typhus. It is caused by Urensia tsutsugamushi. Scrub typhus is a disease which is very common in northern parts of India, especially in the hilly areas such as Himachal Pradesh or Uttarakhand. So scrub typhus is present here. So therefore, it is important for you to learn about this disease. Okay. Now, coming here to the related Rickettsia, I said Coxiella is not a rickettsial bacterium because it is not arthropod borne. It is responsible for Q fever. Q for query, because they did not know the etiology. So it was a query for a long time. It is responsible for endocarditis, and it is often discovered when patient is being evaluated for pyrexia of unknown origin. So endocarditis and Q fever. If you look at the another related organism, that is Bartonella. Remember, Coxiella is a shortness question, so don't ignore it. Bartonella, there are three important pathogenic species of Bartonella. Remember that they are not intracellular pathogen, they can be grown in artificial culture media. The three important species are Hensley, Quintana, and Bacilliformis. Each of these can be asked for 3 marks question. Or even 5 marks question. So Bartonella Hensley is responsible for some of the diseases such as cat scratch disease. So you can get a 3 marks question just as cat scratch disease. Bacillary angiomatosis, bacillary pilosis, this mainly affects the liver, bacteremia and endocarditis. These are the diseases caused by Bartonella Hensley. The other species, Quintana, Bartonella Quintana, is associated with trench fever. This is a fever which used to be seen in soldiers who were dug up in trenches during the First World War. So it is called trench fever or 5-day fever. So similar to Bartonella Hensley, Quintana can also cause bacillary angiomatosis, bacteremia, and endocarditis. The third species, Bacilliformis, is responsible for Carrion's disease, or also known as Bartonellosis, Oroya fever, or Verruca peruana. So these are rarely asked questions, not so commonly asked. So this is one way of studying them. And then another way of studying Rickettsia is by their host. So it can be transmitted through a variety of hosts. So which are these arthropod hosts? Ticks, lice, flea, and mites. Which are the tick-borne diseases? They are, the tick-borne diseases are Rocky Mountain Spotted Fever, which is caused by Rickettsia rickettsii, Indian tick typhus, also known as Boutonnais fever, caused by Rickettsia canori, African tick typhus, caused by Rickettsia africae, and Ehrlichiosis. Remember this, where is it? Yes. Yeah, Ehrlichiosis. This Ehrlichiosis, the bacterium is Ehrlichia chaffinensis. If you look at the lice causes two types of disease, epidemic typhus and trench fever. So remember here, when I was talking about Borrelia, you had relapsing fever. So there were two types of relapsing fever there. Epidemic relapsing fever and endemic relapsing fever. The epidemic relapsing fever was because of lice. Similarly here, the epidemic typhus is louse-borne. So wherever you hear the term epidemic, whether it is relapsing fever or typhus, it is lice-borne. Wherever you hear endemic, it is tick-borne. In Borreliosis, the endemic Borreliosis was tick-borne. And here too, the endemic typhus, as you can see here, the endemic typhus is tick-borne. Okay, coming to the third arthropod, flea. It is responsible for the transfer of, in case of Borreliosis, it was tick. In this case, it is flea here. The endemic typhus is transmitted through fleas. Pardon me for that mistake. In case of Borreliosis, the endemic Borreliosis is because of tick, whereas endemic typhus is because of transmission through flea. And finally, the mites. Mites are responsible for transfer of at least two diseases. Rickettsial pox, which is caused by Rickettsia acari, and scrub typhus, which is caused by Oriensia susugamushi. So this picture shows you the complexity of Rickettsia, the variety of diseases and their vectors. So you will need to put in a lot of effort to try to remember them, as these are highly confusing. For the sake of convenience, some authors divide the Rickettsial diseases. When I say Rickettsial diseases, mind you, I am not including Coxiella and Bartonella, okay? Only the remaining ones are being considered here. So they are divided into three groups. The spotted fever group, the typhus fever group, and the scrub typhus group. Now you know that scrub typhus is not Rickettsia at all. It is caused by Oriensia. Otherwise, you have spotted fever group and typhus fever group. Remember, the genus Rickettsia causes spotted fever, typhus fever. The second genus, Oriensia, causes scrub typhus. I hope this is clear. Now, when we talk about spotted fever group, there are different species of rickettsia which are associated with the different diseases according to their geographical distribution. Rocky Mountain, this is in United States, Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Bhutanese fever, this is in Mediterranean countries, including India, Asia and India. Siberica, Siberia, Australia, probably the northeast of the globe, Oriental, African. So these are the different species of rickettsia named according to the diseases seen in certain geographical area. But in my class, I'll be talking about the Rocky Mountain spotted fever, rickettsial pox, and Bhutanese fever, which is also known as Indian tick typhus.
Okay.
And then we have the typhus fever group. Remember, there are two types, epidemic typhus and endemic typhus. Endemic typhus is also known as murine typhus. Murine are rats, because this is transmitted through fleas, and fleas are found on rats. This disease is also known as murine typhus. So typhus are of two types, epidemic and endemic. Epidemic is louse-borne, whereas endemic is flea-borne. Epidemic is caused by Rickettsia prowazekii, whereas endemic is caused by Rickettsia typhi. Now first let us have a look at the spotted fever group. Rickettsia, Rickettsiae is the prototype of this whole group. That means most of them will have similar features. They are all transmitted through the ticks, except for Acari, which is the mite-borne. So remember that Rickettsia are transmitted transovarially. What do I mean by that? That means when a tick lays her eggs, the eggs are already containing bacteria. So when the newborn hatches from the eggs, it is already infected. So the subsequent generation is already infected. So they are transover. That therefore, these ticks are both vectors as well as reservoirs. Reservoir is something, it is permanent, you know. When you say a water reservoir, we mean there is water is present all the time. So infection can be transmitted by either the adult stage or the larval stage of the ticks. And remember that the ticks are not harmed, and they, even though remain infected for their entire life, they are not affected by it, by the bacteria present in them. Rickettsia are shed in feces, but it is only their bite which is infectious. These are the photos of the tick and its young one. The young ones are called nymph, the adult and the nymph. The genus of the tick is Amblyomma americanum. There are many genera of ticks. Another genera is Dermacentaur. Species is Variabilis. Another one is Ixodes capularis. These are all called hard ticks because their body shell is hard. They are also called Ixodid family of ticks. Hard ticks or Ixodid ticks. You come across these names when you read in some texts. So whether it is Amblyomma, Dermacentaur or Ixodes, they are all called hard ticks or Ixodid ticks. This is the life cycle. The female lays her eggs. The larva comes out, develops into nymph stage, nymph grows into adult, male and female, and then the life cycle continues. So these are the pictures of different tick types. Ornithocissus, Opliocaris, oh, these are names difficult to remember. You don't have to remember their names. So these are just some of the ticks. These are mites. Mites are so small that you may need to use a microscope to see them properly. Ticks can be seen with naked eye. So these are mites. One, two, three. These are mites and the rest of them are all ticks. Okay. So rickettsia are introduced into humans after an infected tick feeds. Generally, when it feeds for more than 6 hours. A tick bite is painless, and therefore, because it is painless, it goes unnoticed. So once the bacteria gains entry into the skin through the bite of the tick, it gains entry into the regional lymphatics, and from the lymphatics, it goes into the bloodstream, and then It attaches itself to the vascular endothelial cells of the blood vessels. So rickettsia have adhesins, which are outer membrane proteins, which allow them to bind to the cell and allow itself to be phagocytosed. So they promote their own phagocytosis inside the cell. Remember that these are an obligate intracellular pathogens. So these OMPs help the bacteria to bind to the surface of the cell and then facilitate their own phagocytosis inside the cell. Inside the cell, they don't accumulate in large numbers. If you recollect, I was talking about chlamydia the other day, where the reticulate body accumulate in large numbers and finally they rupture the cell and release. That doesn't happen in rickettsia. They don't accumulate in large numbers and they do not lyse the infected host cells. But they can move from one cell to another cell by stimulating the polymerization of the actin filaments. So cell to cell transfer will happen by stimulating the polymerization of the host endoskeleton, which are the actins. Or it can escape from the phagosome membrane by an enzyme called phospholipase 2, but there is no rupture of the infected cell. I think we are running out of time here. Well, rickettsia replicate intracellularly at an average of 1 week. So it is 3 to 12 days. So we'll start with the first of the spotted fevers. Remember, rickettsia, the genus Rickettsia, causes two types of diseases, spotted fever and typhus. The second genus of Rickettsia, that is Orientia, causes scrub typhus. Right? So keep these three things in mind. Now, coming to the genus Rickettsia, as I said, it causes two types of diseases, the spotted fever group and the typhus group. So first we'll look at the spotted fever group. There are many in this list, but I'll be talking only about two or three of the spotted fever groups. The number one of them is the Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Why? This is the most severe and most frequently reported disease, especially in the United States of America. Why is it called Rocky Mountain spotted fever? Because it was thought to be limited to the Rocky Mountain area. It is caused by the bacterium Rickettsia, which is the prototype bacterium. Remember, this is the prototype bacterium of the whole genus. Rickettsia, Rickettsia. How is it transmitted to humans? Through the bite of ixodid ticks. Remember, I said ixodid or also known as hard ticks. So disease follows after the bite of an infected tick. Not all ticks are infected. Remember that. The disease follows only after the bite of an infected tick. You will never know which tick is infected and which isn't. Anyway, so after a week with a range of 2 to 14 days, begins with fever, severe headache, myalgia, and then the characteristic appearance of rash. This rash initially appears on the ankles and wrist as faint pink 1 to 5 millimeter macules. This is how the rashes appear. So what are these rashes actually? These rashes are the focus of vascular infection. Remember I told you they bind to the vascular endothelial cells and resulting surrounding vasodilation. So that is one which appears as rashes, macules. Then the lesions may progress from macule to papule, maculopapular. Why? The leakage of edema fluid from the blood vessels. So it progresses from macule to papule because of the edematous nature, because the blood or the plasma flows from infected blood vessels. It worsens to form hemorrhage. This hemorrhage appears on the skin as petechiae. This is a multi-system disease which can infect many organs. This picture is not that clear. Here you can see many macules on the skin, around the palm, wrist, plenty of rashes. A better picture here, which shows plenty of rashes. as a picture. Even though the rashes initially begin in the palms or wrist, it can affect the whole body. Okay. Now coming to the second disease, rickettsial pox. It is called pox because of the characteristic appearance of lesions which may resemble or which may be confused with the lesions of pox. So this is distributed worldwide, has been reported in Russia, South Africa, Korea, that shows its worldwide in distribution. This is caused by acari, Rickettsia acari. And here the disease is not transmitted through ticks, but here it is because of mite. And this mite is a parasite on mouse, domestic mouse, is Mus musculus. So the mite carries Rickettsia acari. It is present on its host, which is the domestic mouse. And when such a mite jumps or leaves the mouse and bites human, people get infected. So the incubation period is around 9 to 14 days. At the site of bite, there is a red papule where the mite has bitten. Once again, people hardly notice it when the mite bites. Then this develops over a period of time into an eschar. I'll show you the picture how the eschar looks like. So after the bite of a mite, a papule, a red color papule, develops at the site of bite 9 to 14 days later, which then develops into an eschar. Following which, there is development of fever, and the fever is fluctuating 38 to 41 degrees. And this febrile condition lasts for a week. Along with fever, patients may also have headache, chills, rigors, profuse sweating, and myalgia. So these are non-specific symptoms. It is difficult to say when a person has fever, headache, chills, rigors, sweating, myalgia, you don't know which organism, whether it is bacteria or virus, which is causing this. So that is why it can be missed at this stage. The next stage is the appearance of vesicular macropapular rash. These are slightly big, vesicular in nature, vesicular macropapular rashes, which are distributed in face, neck, trunk, and extremities. That is almost covering all part of the body. And these rashes subsequently heal within next 2 to 3 days without leaving any scars, without any scarring. There is spontaneous resolution in 2 to 3 weeks. Now, the speciality of this disease is that it is not only exanthematous, but it may also be ananthematous. So you may find these rashes not only on the skin, but also on the mucous membranes. The presentation is so similar to that of chickenpox. So people may confuse this with chickenpox. That is why the disease was initially called rickettsial pox. Okay, this is the picture of the eschar, the site where the mite had bitten. And this is the development of pox. Look at the size of the pox here. This is why this disease was probably confused with the viral disease of chickenpox or smallpox. Both chickenpox and smallpox are viral diseases, whereas rickettsial pox is bacterial disease. And remember that at some point of time, people thought this rickettsia was also perhaps a virus. But now we know it is a bacteria. Coming to the third in the group of spotted fevers, it is the Bouchonese fever. Now these are several names. Also known as African tick typhus, Mediterranean spotted fever, Israeli spotted fever, Indian tick typhus, or Marsalis fever. This is a tick-borne disease. It is transmitted, it is caused by Rickettsia conori, the name of the species which causes Bouchonese fever or Indian tick typhus is conori, Rickettsia conori. So the features of this disease is similar to that of Rocky Mountain spotted fever. So as with that case, there are rashes here, incubation period around 6 days. There may be an eschar at the site of bite, and there may be necrosis on the skin, which is caused by the vasculitis at the point of bite of the tick, which slowly heals over a period of 10 to 20 days without leaving any scar. So this is about the three spotted fever groups. Now we move on to the second group of diseases, that is the typhus group of diseases. Remember here, in typhus, we have two type of typhus, epidemic typhus and endemic typhus. There is a form of epidemic typhus which recurs after some time. It is called recrudescent typhus, which is also known by another name called Brill-Zinsser disease. So Brill-Zinsser disease is a recrudescent form of epidemic typhus. Remember this. This recrudescence does not happen with endemic typhus. Okay. So first we'll have a look at the epidemic typhus. Epidemic typhus is louse-borne. Hence, it is also known as louse-borne typhus. Remember that with the relapsing fever, the epidemic relapsing fever was also known as louse-borne relapsing fever. Okay, coming back here now, this is worldwide in distribution, but rare in India. There have been only a handful of cases reported from India. It is caused by the organism Rickettsia provazekii, named after Provazek. Provazek and his colleague, they wanted to know the pathogenesis, though they were working on it, and finally they succumbed to the disease typhus on which they were working. So such was the dedication of these people. Humans are the only natural vertebrate host, so they are not found in animals. So the disease is transmitted from person to another person through body louse. It has also been reported in some flying squirrels. We do not know how much they are involved in the transmission of disease. But it is mainly the human body louse, Pediculus humanus corporis. This is the scientific name of human body louse. This is the vector. There are no animals involved. Human to human transfer. Head louse may also transmit the disease. Remember that in case of borreliosis, head louse was not transmitting the disease. But in case of typhus fever, head louse may also transfer the disease. But the primary vector is still the body louse, Pediculus humanus corporis. It is not transmitted through the bite of pubic louse. This is usually transmitted by body louse, person to person, usually under the conditions of crowding and poor hygiene. This happens when people are living in refugee camps, in prisons, all those difficult conditions where there is overcrowding of people and poor hygiene. So lice become infected when they feed on an infected individual. The bacteria multiplies in the gut of the lice, it appears in the feces in 3 to 5 days, and then it becomes infective after 1 week after being infected. So once a louse feeds on an infected person, for it to become infective to another person, it will take about a week's time. This period is also known as extrinsic incubation period. So the infected lice usually die within 1 to 3 weeks. Why? Because of obstruction of the alimentary tract. So these bacteria now multiply in its intestine and block it, and such infected lice die in 1 to 3 weeks. The bacteria are not transferred to their offspring. So it is just one generation of louse that is affected. It is not transmitted transovarially as it is in the case of ticks. Here it is not because of the bite. Please note that. When the louse is singular, lice is plural. When the louse feeds on a human host, it defecates immediately. And when people try to scratch it or rub it, the bacteria present in the feces is unknowingly transferred or rubbed inside the bite wound or the scratches that is caused, the abrasions which are caused by scratches, that will facilitate the entry of the bacteria into the person. It is not transmitted through the bite. It is transmitted through the feces contaminating the bite wound or through the abrasions of the skin which develop because of scratching activity. This is a picture which shows the different stage and gender. This is male and female body louse. These are different stages of growth. Picture which shows the body louse feeding on humans, and these are the rashes seen on the person. This is a highly infective organism. Please note that the infectious dose is less than 10 bacilli. So less than 10 organism can cause infection, and that is why Rickettsia provazekii has been explored as a potential bioterrorism agent or used for biological warfare. Even though the United Nations has banned this, some countries are still probably covertly following it. Who knows? Why this is a potential bioterrorism agent? It's because the bacteria remains stable in dried louse feces. Remember, I told you that this bacterium is so-called alive only when it is intracellular. Outside, just like virus, it's neither dead nor living. So it remains stable. It can be delivered in the form of aerosols. So that is why it can be used for bioterrorism or biological warfare. So the infection is of endothelial cells, of capillaries and small blood vessels. As a result, it causes vasculitis. When there is vasculitis, there is fibrin deposition and platelet aggregation. All of it will result in occlusion of the blood vessels. Which blood vessels? The capillaries and small blood vessels. Okay. As a result of this vasculitis, there will be gangrene of the skin because the affected part is not getting blood supply. The blood supply is cut off. So there may be gangrene of the skin when the thrombosis is severe. Vasculitis will also affect not only the skin, but heart, CNS, skeletal muscles, and kidneys. So this is what makes the disease dangerous. The bacteria attaches to the endothelial cells, smaller blood vessels and capillaries, ultimately leading to blockage of blood supply. If you look at the clinical onset of this, it is abrupt after an incubation of 14 days, 2 weeks, sudden onset of the disease. It starts with rashes appearing on the trunk and then spreading onto the limbs, but face and palm are not affected. So these are the small things that you should remember, how you differentiate it from other exanthematous disease. So what you notice here is that the rash is starting on trunk and then to limbs, but it is not seen on face or palm. Okay. Now towards the second week of the disease, the patient becomes stuporous and delirious. This is why the disease is called typhus. The word typhus means a cloudy state of mind. This is because of the stuporous and delirious mental condition, cloudy state of mind. Cloudy state of mind means typhus. The case fatality is around 40%. Now remember that I spoke about the disease called typhoid. In typhoid also there is a such similar condition. To differentiate it from typhus, and because it was slightly similar to typhus, the disease was called typhoid. Typhoid is caused by salmonella. Okay, now coming back to this. If it is uncomplicated, the fever resolves after 2 weeks, uneventfully. But in some people who recover, note here, the rickettsia may remain latent in lymphoid tissues or lymphoid organs. So patient has recovered, but the bacteria has not been eradicated. It persists, not in the blood vessels, but in lymphoid tissues or lymphoid organs. These bacteria, after some time, they multiply there and come back once again into the blood, resulting in reactivation of the disease. This is called recrudescent typhoid or Brill-Zinsser disease. This can be identified by a test called Tunica reaction. I'll talk about this later. Now coming to the second one, second type of typhus. So far I spoke to you on the epidemic typhus. Now I'll speak to you on endemic typhus. Endemic typhus is flea-borne. Epidemic typhus is louse-borne. And because the fleas are found on the rats, it is also called murine typhus. Epidemic typhus is caused by Rickettsia provosaciae, whereas endemic typhus is caused by Rickettsia typhi. So here the bacteria are found in small animals such as rats, cats, possums, and they are transmitted through the bite of their ectoparasites, that is the fleas. So the life cycle of Rickettsia typhi involves the rats and its ectoparasite, that is the rat flea. What is the name of the rat flea? Xenopsella chiopis. Where else have you heard of this name, rat flea? Xenopsella chiopis, responsible for another bacterial disease, the plague, where it is caused by a bacterium called Yersinia pestis. So, which is the disease that is associated with rat flea? First one is plague, second one is endemic typhus. So, remember these are the viva questions here. Okay, so Rickettsia typhi causes endemic typhus, also known as flea borne typhus, also known as murine typhus. It is transmitted through the bite of rat flea, which is known as Xenopsella chiopis. So the rickettsia multiply in the gut of the flea and is shed in its feces. Flea is unaffected by the bacterium and it remains infective for its entire lifespan. How do people get infected? People get infected by the bite of the infected flea. Okay? When their saliva or feces, any of them, because saliva may also contain bacteria. Feces will also contain bacteria. When either of them is rubbed into the bite wound or into the abrasions caused by scratching, or if the dried feces is present on the animal, if that feces get aerosolized, dispersed into air, and the person happens to breathe in such an air, people can get infected. Remember this third point also, even though it is flea borne, not only through the flea, but also through the dried feces of the fleas, which are now dispersed in aerosols, can also be infective to human. Rodent, it's flea, so it's a life cycle among themselves. So when such infected flea will now jump to humans to draw human blood, people get infected. Similar condition is seen in plague. Ingestion of food contaminated with rat's urine may also transmit the infection. So in contamination of food by rat's urine or the feces of the flea can also transmit infection. So now you know there are three modes of transmission of endemic typhus. One is through the bite of the fleas. Two, through inhalation of the dried feces of the flea. Three, contamination of food by either the rat's urine or the flea's feces. So three modes of transmission are there. There is no human to human transmission of this disease. The symptoms which appears after 1 to 2 weeks includes fever with chills, headache, myalgia, once again non-specific symptoms here, and then here also there is development of rash. But rash develops, but this rash may not be seen in all the patients. Whenever it begins in the trunk and spreads to the extremities. So you note that in all of this rickettsial fever, whether it is a spotted fever group or whether it is a typhus group, rashes is common. The disease is mild and resolves in 3 weeks. Even if it is not treated, mortality is low. So compare this with the mortality associated with the epidemic typhus. It is high there, whereas the mortality in endemic typhus is low. And it is more commonly in elderly patients. So mortality, if at all seen, is seen in elderly patients. So we have two species here. Both of them are causing typhus. Rickettsia typhi, which causes the endemic typhus, and Rickettsia provazaki, which causes epidemic typhus. They are both closely related. They can be differentiated based on the surface antigens using immunofluorescence or ELISA, or by PCR, or by a test known as Neal-Moser reaction. This is also known as Tunica reaction. This is a question that is sometimes asked in examination, Neal-Moser reaction. Neal-Moser reaction is a test done to distinguish between Rickettsia typhi and Rickettsia provazachii. How is this done? When the blood from the patient, or you have taken culture here, is inoculated intraperitoneally into a male guinea pig. So what is inoculated? The microorganism, either from the specimen or from the culture, is inoculated into a male guinea pig. There is a development of a characteristic scrotal inflammation. Its scrotus is inflamed. The scrotum is enlarged and testes can't be pushed back into the abdomen. Why? Because there is inflammatory adhesion between the layers of tunica vaginalis. Therefore, this reaction is also known as tunica reaction, and this is known as Neal-Moser's reaction. Which organism of the two is positive? Only the Rickettsia provazachii. Rickettsia provazachii, the one which causes epidemic typhus, is positive for Neal-Moser reaction, whereas Rickettsia typhi, which is responsible for endemic typhus, is negative for Neal-Moser reaction. So now with that, we have finished talking on the Rickettsia genus. Now coming to the second genus of the family Rickettsiaceae, that is Orientia. Orientia susugamushi is responsible for scrub typhus. This is seen across Asia, Australia, and Pacific Islands, It is also seen in India. As I already stated, it is seen in the northern part of India, including Himachal Pradesh, Jammu Kashmir, and Uttarakhand. So then here, the bacterium is transmitted to humans through the bite of chiggers. What are chiggers? Chiggers are the larval forms of a mite. In fact, any stage of mite can transfer this, but this is more common. Chiggers are more common, but even the adult form of mite can also bite. So mite is the both reservoir and vector. Why? Because the transmission is transovarial. Not only this, rodents are also reservoirs. So these mites feeding on rodents, rodents get infected subclinically. From rodents, mites get infected, mites bite humans, humans get infected. So the normal cycle is mite to rodent and rodent to mite. It revolves around mite and its rodent. Humans are only accidentally infected. Anyway, after an incubation period of 1 to 3 weeks, the disease is manifested by sudden onset of fever, chills, headache, and myalgia. See, these are all the symptoms which are common to all of this rickettsial fever. And then once again, here too, there is development of maculopapular rash, which appears first on the trunk and that spreads on the extremities. Such a distribution is called centrifugal spread. So which is similar to the typhus, the previous typhus also the distribution was same. So this is how the pathogenesis, the clinical presentation, incubation period, they are more or less similar. So this is a picture which shows the adult mite, and these are these larval forms, the chiggers. These are the chiggers and this is the adult form. So at the site of bite, there is an eschar, and then there are rashes in the abdomen and other parts of body. So now we come to laboratory diagnosis. So now we'll go ahead with laboratory diagnosis. Now laboratory diagnosis is important here. Why? Because the disease presentation is so much similar among the various diseases we have seen. Even though the treatment is more or less same, just for the sake of knowledge, for the sake of correct diagnosis, you will have to perform the laboratory diagnosis. Most commonest specimen taken is the blood. And the methods used are culture, which is not found everywhere. This is not so common. Serodiagnosis, this is the most common one. Detecting antibodies in patient's blood. Or three, molecular, once again, it is not very common. So when we talk of culture, remember I told you that they cannot be grown on artificial culture media. They need a living cell. So they can be grown in animals such as guinea pig or mouse, or they can be grown in eggs, that is the chick's egg or embryonated egg, or it can be grown on tissue culture. So when we talk of the serological diagnosis, we mean detection of antibodies. One of the oldest tests to be used for serological diagnosis of rickettsial diseases is Weil-Felix test. Nowadays, we have got microimmunofluorescence or ELISA, which can detect even IgG or IgM antibodies. Remember that Weil-Felix test is a heterophile test. What is meant by heterophile test? By heterophile, we mean the similar antigens present on dissimilar species. What is it? Similar antigens present on dissimilar species. See, when a person is suffering from rickettsial diseases, obviously you will expect that the person's blood will have antibodies to rickettsial antigen. However, it has been accidentally found that such antibodies, which are produced against rickettsia, are reacting with certain Proteus bacteria. Proteus is a member of Enterobacteriaceae. So Proteus and rickettsia are completely unrelated bacteria. So here what is happening is there are some antigens which are present on the surface of certain Proteus strains are accidentally similar to some antigens which are present on rickettsia. There is this cross reaction between dissimilar species. So such antigens are called heterophile antigens, and those tests which employ such antigens are called heterophile tests. So Weil-Felix is a heterophile test. And because it employs Proteus bacterium, you cannot consider this as a specific test. So when we talk of the molecular methods, it includes detection of the genes by PCR. We'll see about the Weil-Felix test soon. So when we talk about the animal inoculation, the blood is allowed to clot, then it is ground in skimmed milk, and then it is inoculated intraperitoneally into the guinea pig. And then the animal is observed daily for 3 to 4 weeks, and its body temperature is observed. We should look for development of fever in the animal. Its Neal-Moses reactions, scrotal necrosis should be observed, death of the animal. So in case of Rocky Mountain spotted fever, you will find only scrotal necrosis, fever and death. In case of Rickettsia typhi, you will find tunica reaction. And in case of Prawasaki, fever without testicular inflammation. So this is how you can differentiate using the animals. And then the peritoneal fluid is taken from the animal, or the specimen is taken from its scrotum or the spleen, and then stained by GIMS or Gemina stain and looked for intracellular bacteria. And then the growth in tissue culture can also be seen by immunofluorescence. So by immunofluorescence, this is what I mean. The infected cells will appear bright. These are the bright yellow spots you can see here. This represents the bacteria inside the infected cells. Now coming to the Weil-Felix test. Weil-Felix test is a commonly asked short notes question in exam. Remember, I said it is a heterophile test. Since the test is performed in test tubes, it is called a tube agglutination test. It was described by Edmund Weil and Arthur Felix. That is why it is called Weil-Felix. Look at the time, 1916. Such an old test is still being performed. Okay, so principle. This test is based on the antigenic cross-reaction between certain protea species and Rickettsia. So which are these protea species? Note this point. The typhus group of Rickettsia. Which are the typhus groups? Rickettsia prawasaki and Rickettsia typhi. The typhus group of Rickettsia cross reacts with Proteus vulgaris strain OX19. Please note this down. The typhus group of Rickettsia, that is Rickettsia prawasaki and Rickettsia typhi, they cross react with Proteus vulgaris OX19 strain. Whereas the organism causing scrub typhus, which is Oriensia susugamushi, the antigen cross reacts with Proteus mirabilis OXK. Therefore, for Weil-Felix test, two antigens are taken. Antigen 1 is Proteus vulgaris OX19. They are non-motile strains. Please note that they are non-motile strains. Proteus vulgaris OX19 and Proteus mirabilis OXK. So these are the two strains, non-motile strains of Proteus, which are used in Weil-Felix test. The spotted fever group. First I spoke of typhus fever group, then I spoke of scrub typhus. Now coming to the spotted fever group. The spotted fever group Rickettsia, example, Rickettsia, Africa, Japonica and so on, they react with Proteus vulgaris OX2 and OX19 to varying degrees. So they may agglutinate with either OX2 or OX19. So here you will need to interpret it. I'll show you the table. If agglutination is seen with Proteus vulgaris OX19, it is likely to be typhus group. If it reacts with OXK, it is likely to be scrub typhus. And for spotted fever group, we'll see in the chart. Okay. So this is the chart here. Please note down this chart. In case of epidemic typhus, the agglutination is a tube agglutination test, remember. The agglutination is positive, 3+, that is heavy agglutination. Good agglutination is seen with 19 and poor with OX2 and none with OXK. In case of murine typhus, positive with OX19, not so with, or mildly so with OX2. So remember this is based on the agglutination pattern here of OX19, OX2 and OXK, the different types of Rickettsial diseases or associated diseases can be diagnosed. So So this is something which you will have to perhaps mug it up. There is no other way of learning this. The problem with Weil-Felix test, okay, also know that in case of trench fever and case of Q fever, Weil-Felix test is absolutely useless. So when you're suspecting either of these two, don't go for Weil-Felix test. Anyway, Weil-Felix tests suffer from poor sensitivity and specificity. Both of them are poor. It is low in sensitivity and low in specificity. Sensitivity is as low as 33% and specificity is as low as 46%. This is too low. So that is why the results of Weil-Felix test is not confirmatory. That is why in many countries, Weil-Felix test has been abandoned. Okay, now we are coming to the last of the rickettsia. I've got only two more minutes. The next one is the family Anaplasmataceae, the member being Ehrlichia. Okay, this is an old text. I have not changed it. It is no longer rickettsia. If you remember, it's Anaplasmataceae. It is also an obligate intracellular parasite. Okay, so it grows within the phagosome in a mulberry-like cluster. So that is how it can be identified. This is called morula. Symptoms appear between 1 to 21 days. It's a mild or asymptomatic illness, or it can become severe life-threatening disease. Clinical feature is very similar to the previous ones: fever, headache, myalgia, malaise, nausea, vomiting, so on. Rash may be present in 20% of cases. The bacterium, the main bacterium here is species is Ehrlichia chaffensis. It invades the blood cells and it somehow affects the body's immune system. So it induces a slight amount of immunodeficiency. The three diseases which are associated with Ehrlichia are Sennetsu fever in Japan, human monocytic Ehrlichiosis, and human granulocytic Ehrlichiosis. They're caused by three different species. Sennetsu fever is caused by Ehrlichia sennetsu. Human monocytic Ehrlichiosis is called by chaffensis. Human granulocytic Ehrlichiosis is caused by equii. This has no arthropod vector. It is probably transmitted through ingestion, characterized by lymphoid hyperplasia and atypical lymphocytosis. Disease is rare, no fatalities. And the second one, the monocytic Ehrlichiosis, is transmitted through the dicks, through the ticks. Deer and rodents are reservoirs. And third one, human granulocytic Ehrlichiosis, is also transmitted through ticks. Deer, cattle, and sheep are reservoirs. So with this, I have finished speaking on the Rickettsiae. When I say Rickettsiae, I spoke of three genera here. Number one was Rickettsia itself, number two was Orientia, and number three was Ehrlichia. There are other two species of this family. I'm not going to talk about that. In my next class, I'll be talking about Coxiella and Bartonella, which were once in Rickettsia, but now not considered to be Rickettsial organism. With this, I complete my today's class. In my next class, I'll talk of Coxiella and Bartonella. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.